So kind of overview of some of the things that I'll be covering tonight, just because, again, I want you guys to ask questions and contribute in discussion as we go along, but to give you an overlay of what we're going to be looking at. The first is some of the key lessons learned just about growth in general at some of the companies that have gone on to become unicorns. So some of the prerequisites for actually being able to drive growth. Then I'll talk about building an effective growth team and how that growth team works to manage a growth process. And then I'll share some examples. So first thing I want to talk about is, again, some of the key lessons that I learned in the companies that I've worked with is that growth looks like this. I mean, I think a lot of people, when they think about growth, they originally think, you know, marketing and what people can do out in the channels to acquire customers. But the truth is, you know, Dave McClure's R framework was pretty revolutionary a few years ago when he published it. And it's essentially the funnel and the levers within that funnel that you can work, and that different groups within the organization are responsible for working those levers. So marketing does play an important role in growth, but product plays an equally important role, particularly deeper down around that first user experience. If you don't nail that first user experience, there generally isn't a second user experience. And then the ongoing experience. If the ongoing experience isn't great, if you have a high churn rate, particularly if you're in a SaaS business, there is a theoretical max that you kind of get that business to. If your churn rate is so high, your bar as somebody who's responsible for customer acquisition just becomes harder and harder to grow that business if you have a high churn rate. Referrals are based on a good ongoing experience. So part of the prerequisites to growth, and this was me coming off of especially the early stage companies where I was focused on growth, I came away with this pyramid idea that if you don't have product market fit, which is something a lot of people talk about today, but if you don't have the right product in the right market, your potential of being able to drive growth is really low. And then, but once you have the right product in the right market, there's a lot of things that you can do to ultimately make a business much more growable. And that's what I call just the stacking the odds part of growth, and then scaling growth. Once you've got the right product in the right market, you've done all these things that stack the odds for growth, then scaling growth becomes a lot easier. And we'll spend most of the time talking about actually scaling growth, but it's important to touch on this. So product market fit, I know a lot of you guys understand this, but it's just, you know, I'm going to reference it really quickly, but it is the most important factor for driving growth. So all of you that are in product, this is where your role starts, is the right product in the right market, and that by far outweighs any tactical customer acquisition things that you can do. Right product and right market is gonna be essential for driving growth. You wanna make sure it's a large addressable market and that your product is a must have for those people in that market. This is a question that I like to use to validate that. So I just ask people on the product, how would you feel if you could no longer use this product? And I'm looking for people who say they'd be very disappointed. Stacking the odds for growth is about really understanding those users who say they would be very disappointed without your product, those users who continue to use it over time. You want to understand everything you can about those users. So first of all, who are they? What are the characteristics of those people? What makes the product a must-have for them? What's the key benefit that they're getting from the product? How are they actually using the product? So there's a ton of insights that you can get from these people that ultimately allow you to be more effective in actually driving good onboarding and getting the right users in the first place. And then ultimately what you're trying to do with that information is optimize your value delivery machine based on that information. So if you create a promise based on what makes the product a must-have, then you're setting the right expectations on that product. You're actually gonna be able to deliver on what someone hopes to get from that product, and then you wanna really focus your onboarding experience to get people to that must-have experience. If you can get them on an initial visit to the must-have experience of the product, the thing that changes someone from saying it's a nice to have to, oh my gosh, I can't live without this, then they're much more likely to come back. All value is basically correlated to that. They're much more likely to come back. They're much more likely to spread the word. They're much more likely to ultimately pay money. So now the rest of the time we're gonna talk about scaling growth, which is the fun part. Scaling growth starts with testing. So testing is absolutely critical. This is an example or an analogy that I borrowed from Brian Balfour. It's just a really good one. essentially anyone who knows Battleship, every test that you're running, even if it's not successful, you're learning something. You want to run as many tests across the R kind of framework as you can. And over time, you're going to get smarter about where within the R is your best opportunity right now. But you want to make sure that you're running tests from acquisition all the way down to retention, revenue, referral. So I think of tests as kind of two different types of tests. There's tests to discover. So they're basically, those are the pings. Those are the things where you, it's maybe the first time that you're checking in a channel or the first time that you're adding a feature, but something that's ultimately giving you signal if there's something there or not. And then, of course, the other type of tests is A/B tests or just comparison tests. Maybe you have enough traffic where you can actually do multivariate tests, but it's ultimately about the recognition that everything you're doing, there's a better way to do it if you can just figure out what that better way is. And this is the part that might be a little bit counterintuitive for some people. Yes, you want to run high quality tests, but the truth is that a lot of people get caught up in trying to run the perfect test and don't end up testing very much when at the end of the day, you don't know if a test is a great test until after you've run it. Great example is looking at what Twitter did. There's a presentation by Satya Patel from last year that he talks about that when he joined Twitter as the VP of product, they were doing, you know, one test every other week. Once they flipped it to doing 10 tests per week, it turned the corner and helped them to be able to be a lot smarter about the learning that they were doing. If you're running that many tests, having easy access to the testing history becomes important. You want to have test results available in a knowledge base. Capture the key lessons learned from the testing. That's the whole point of running testing is to learn. So make sure that the lessons learned are upfront for you. And then as many of the details as you can attach to that test as possible. So screenshots of the before and after. What was the hypothesis when you originally did the test? And then any of the analysis. You didn't have the punchline, but include links to the analysis, include, you know, screenshots of the analysis if you need to, but just try to make sure that you've kind of aggregated that information together and it's accessible for the team. Ultimately, running a high tempo testing process, running lots of tests, comes down to the team and the process. And so we'll look at the team first. So we talked about this, you know, ultimately growth kind of looks like this. It's different groups are affecting growth across each of those levers. But the growth team tends to sit right on top. It tends to be a cross discipline team that is made up of people from kind of each of the areas. I think in a lot of groups, it actually sits in the product team now, because at least the product team has access generally to development resources. But in some organizations, it reports into marketing. But wherever it is, you just want to make sure that you're thinking of it as something that's trying to tie together tests that are running in each of these areas and coordinating those tests across those groups. The growth team is then executing this process, and I'll go into details on what the process looks like. But I wanted to first just kind of start with what are the elements, and I'll show that image in a second too. The elements of a growth team, at the very least, I would start with a PM of growth. And you can borrow resources from the rest of the organization initially, but just start with the PM of growth, add the dedicated resources as needed to hit your tempo test, your tempo goals. And then the other thing, particularly in external channels, you want to make sure that you kind of tap into the best external experts, particularly as you're exploring new channels. Once you have a channel working for you, so if SEO is a really important channel for you, then maybe you want to have that expertise internally. But when you're initially exploring a channel, I think it's better to work with an external expert and then hire once you start to see some signal there. So the process becomes really important for the team to actually be effective. So we're going to spend a lot of time talking about process. Process might look different for different groups. This is the process that we follow, and I think it's pretty similar to what a lot of people follow. So it starts with building a big backlog of ideas, and I'll talk in more detail about each of these, but building a big backlog of ideas, week to week prioritizing those ideas of which tests you're actually going to run, then in weekly sprints actually launching tests, capturing the learning from those tests. Again, that the reason you're testing is to learn, capturing the learning from those tests, and then using that information to drive more ideas. So we'll look at unbridled ideation first. And so I think about the growth team as really being that middle layer. And you're going to have some insights from the growth team about ideas to potentially run, but you want to make sure that you're tapping external people for ideas, you know, external content and people for ideas about what's happening out in the channels, because again, it's a moving target. What works this week is likely not going to work a month or two from now. But you also have a lot of internal insights across your team. So people on your support team are going to know where people are having challenges when they're onboarding onto your product. They're going to probably be more insightful around that. Your sales team might have more insights around how your product compares to some of the competitive products or how people are discovering your product. So there's basically these little pockets of knowledge there. So unbridled ideation, as I talked about, our analyst is that big picture there. So basically celebrating who's contributing ideas across the team and making sure that, particularly when new people are giving ideas, I know from past experience that it's tempting to try to tell people don't give us ideas, because sometimes it's kind of a pain in the ass explaining why it's a bad idea or not. So but ultimately, if you want to run lots of tests week in and week out, you're eventually going to kind of tap out the creative energy in the smaller growth team, and you're going to want to solicit ideas from the broader organizations. Our team has 450 ideas in our backlog. I think we're almost 500 now in our backlog, and then we've got active tests and tests in our knowledge base. And when you're getting ideas, you want to make sure that they're not just, because this is the challenge when you start to get ideas from the rest of the team, is that somebody will say, I want to just make that page blue on the background. Like, oh, okay, you know, so there could be a lot of education around that. So you want to make sure that you kind of do a little bit of education around, you know, at least have a hypothesis, at least be able to say why you think that's an idea that's going to actually affect results. So this impact, confidence, and ease score, there's different companies use kind of different scores around it. There's high scores some people use, but basically you want to look at the idea on a kind of a few different criteria. We score on impact, confidence, and ease. So impact, if it works, is this going to be a game changer, or is it like it could help a bit? And so if it's a game changer, we would give it a 10. If it's something that you know, maybe it's really easy and we have a ton of confidence it's going to work, but it's not going to move the needle that much, probably still worth testing. So the ideal tests are going to be high impact, high confidence, and high ease, but usually there's trade-offs. When you're prioritizing the backlog now and deciding which tests to run, that's the benefit of when you actually score the ideas. So you could easily do this in a spreadsheet as well. But basically, when you're now comparing ideas, you can sort by, you know, what are the easiest ideas that we could run. So maybe we're really tight on resources this week and we want to hit our testing goal. So let's nominate some ideas that are super easy. Or like I said, if you want to get some wins and you don't care so much about the impact, but you just want the team buying into the process, you can sort by confidence, or you can do like a weighted score of across the board. So when it comes time to running the test itself and choosing, as I said, like we do nominations on our team where each person on our team is trying to nominate a couple ideas, ideally not their own idea, because then it's just like a fight over, you know, whose idea is better. And then we go in and each person actually gives a little 30-second pitch on why they think it's a good test to run this week. And in our meetings, we're pretty good at basically deciding quickly as a team. Usually we can eliminate a bunch of tests because they conflict with a test that we're already running. And so we'll like, you know, say, oh, we're going to have to push that one for at least another week. Generally we're able to narrow it down, but if not, then, you know, the person who's running the process, so whether it's your PM of growth, your growth master, whatever you're calling it, should just make the call. And then managing the testing queue, it's just really important that each test that you decide to do, you have one person who's assigned to project manage that test, because if you don't, then it's really hard to be able to hold them accountable and know if it didn't launch, why it didn't launch. And then communicating when they get released, so everyone across the team knows. So we communicate it over Slack anytime a new test gets launched. everyone on the Slack channel knows that a new test is live, and they're not surprised when they see it out in the wild. Capturing learning is the last piece. So again, the whole reason for running the testing is for the learning. So you want to make sure that you're clear about the learning, capturing what that key lesson learned is, and that you've made that learning accessible and transparent to the rest of the team if you want their participation. If you don't want their participation, then maybe it's less important. But I think in the long run, you'll be better off if you can get everybody engaged in the growth process. And I know that at Dropbox, that was something that was really effective. So this is the agenda that we use for our growth meeting. We try to stay really tight on that agenda. So KPI review, we're doing like a lot of prep before this meeting. So our product manager of growth is sitting down with the analysts and really making sure that they've thought through the KPIs that make sense to share in that meeting, and where new opportunities might be in terms of where to focus efforts. What you can see is I just listed who attends our growth meetings down below. So it's an expensive meeting, but it's one that basically has the people who can make the decisions to shift resources around if the resources aren't there. Just a couple of examples of some tests, particularly on the product side. You can see super simple examples, but it's ultimately, you never know what's gonna work and what's not gonna work. And so you can see like related posts is on so many sites that's out there. So it's an obvious test to run, and it's a test that actually worked really well for us when we ran it on growthhackers.com and led to more time on site. And then this is just an example from Dropbox. And you can start to see in any product the different growth levers that are there. And I love watching Dropbox over the years just add more and more stuff. Like this is pretty new. But basically when you hover over the little Dropbox icon, you see an upgrade prompt on there, which probably started with a revenue test. You see, start automatically pulling your photos in, which is going to lead to more space, which is going to drive more revenue. And it's also going to drive more engagement on the product. And then the share link. So all of your recent files saved, so this presentation, for example, they make it really easy to embed or to grab the share link directly to that presentation. And then someone who clicks on that share link is going to see the presentation in the background, but with an overlay of a sign-up prompt for Dropbox. And just they're smart about what they're doing, so just assume that every one of those prompts to upgrade, every one of those prompts to share has been tested in multiple variations, and then this landing page has been tested in multiple variations, and that altogether, that's been a big part of driving the growth that they have, because you don't see a whole lot of Dropbox ads out there. Don't consider any of these types of tests as silver bullets. The silver bullet is really having the growth team executing the process in the right way, and over time, that drives the result. That's it.
John, awesome. Thank you.